So, mate, when you're jigging for your flatties, what are the sort of top five or so lures that you really like to use?
Yeah, predominantly a 3-inch size plastic is my ultimate size. In order, probably the Riptide mullet being the first. These are very durable plastic, and they have a absolute fantastic working tail.
Sure.
So couple that with a 3/8 ounce jig head, and the way it falls is perfect.
Yeah.
So they are probably number one. The 80 mil squidgy fish.
Yep. Classic.
Classic, and black and gold predominantly. Mm-hmm. Number one. Again, always have them in my gear bag, and yeah, great plastic.
So that's another 3-inch one, isn't it?
That's another 3-inch one. Yep. So that's number two. Number three is the new squidgy prawn.
Yeah, they're a good lure, aren't they?
Extremely good lure. Flathead, jewfish,
yep.
Bream,
yep.
Reddies, lots of different species.
And you prefer the paddle tail to the
I prefer the paddle tail. Yep. Again, keeping in vogue of the same principles as the other ones, the way that the paddle tail works. But yes, these have been very good and had some really good success with them since they've come out. Jewfish and flatties.
Yeah. Well, so, they're commonly available. So
and
that's
they are
a
commonly
good
available. So two squidgy products. Number four is the Pro Lure trick bait.
Yeah, they're an Aussie company, aren't
they're
they?
They're an Aussie company. Have other types of plastics and that, but again, in these paddle tail styles, this is a 4-inch one. I'm out of the 3-inch at the moment.
Yeah.
But again, a very good plastic. Yeah. And work very
well. You really
well.
Like those sort of darkish natural colours, don't
I was,
you?
I was about to say, I like to keep it in the motor oily sort of root beers, reds, black and golds, more of the natural colours, and they tend to sort of produce the goods. And then you have the Berkeley Power Bait ripple shad.
Yep.
Again, readily available in all shops.
Yep.
3-inch, you know, again, like a black and gold.
Yeah.
And yeah, a very good tail action.
Yeah, it's not a bad fish, Ian.
Yeah.
Whoa! Not a dewy.
No. No, it's a flatty. Leader.
Yeah, there he is. Oh, nice fish. Oh, nice work, mate.
Well done. Whee. Look after them, hold them right. Don't hang them up by the head. Support their underbelly, all the weight so as it's not pulling down off the back of their head. We'll just measure this one up and get an idea of what it measures. Almost a 75. We're ready for this one to go. Biting down nicely. And off she goes.
Unexpectedly compact, uncompromising reliability, unbelievably fuel efficient, unbridled power. Mercury has delivered a new range of 75 to 115 horsepower four-stroke outboards, unlike anything the world has ever seen. Unthink everything you know about four-stroke.
Walking the banks is a great way to spend an afternoon. Casting lures around rocky points and weed beds and flats. Good chance of getting some really good quality fish doing that. And it's just good to be, you know, walking and it's pretty easy fishing really. You just need a rod and a few lures and a bit of spare trace. It's quite laid back and easy. But I guess the main thing about coming up here is just that it's so different from where I fish at home. The country's different. The weather is completely unpredictable. It can be quite nice and pleasant 1 minute and then, you know, freezing cold the next. You have to be prepared for all eventualities. You know, it can be quite, get really cold. I mean, up here, if you're not got the right gear, you can get yourself in serious trouble. And I guess also just the landscape, you've got the big sort of hills and mountains surrounding the lake, and then the sort of almost lunar-like landscape of the lake itself with the barren rocks and sandy foreshores.
We're just up here in the Snowy Mountains, and we're just going to be talking about lure casting from the shoreline. It's one of the easiest kinds of fishing you can do here. You don't need a boat. We've got a boat only because we're using it to go from spot to spot. But you can pull up on the shore, jump out, little pack full of lures, and away you go. It's a very effective, easy way to fish. What we're going to be using is just a standard small thread line outfit. So this is just the same as you'd be using for bream or any estuary fishing. And there's a variety of different lures that we're using. These little hard bodies are really good, and I tend to always go for the shallow runners because the spots I like to fish are usually 6 feet deep or less. And so something like that, small shallow running Rapala, this little Storm, or even one of these little bushy stiffy minnows. So anything about that sort of size, a little bit bigger. Whether they're floaters or suspenders doesn't really matter, but probably not the sinking lures. And then it's just a matter of tying them on, walking the shoreline and casting. So you're just covering water, and what we're looking for is we're fishing the edges for the fish that are in hunting things like yabbies and small bait fish. So the fish that are already looking to feed, all we're doing is putting something in front of them for them to eat, and it's as easy as that. Soft plastics are also very popular these days, and they work as well on trout. The kind that I like, and I'm still experimenting and I'm still learning with it, but I like these smallish ones, and I really like the squidgies. They've just got the nice soft tail, and I like the wriggle tails, but I use a jig head that's probably a bit bigger than most people would think of for a tail this size, because I don't use my soft plastics the same way as I would for bream or flathead. I'm not jigging it to the bottom and flicking it up. I just cast it out, steady retrieve all the way back in. And the reason I do that is the areas that I'm doing this kind of fishing is only sort of 4 foot of water or less. And so there's lots of snags and stuff on the bottom. So I don't want my lure getting in contact with the bottom. So I just flick it out, straight retrieve back in. And a jig head that big is perfect for that kind of fishing. And it also allows me a fair bit of punch if I'm casting into the wind. So I put a little bit of X factor on as well. I think that makes a difference. And it's really as simple as that. It's just cast them out and wind them back in.
fair to say that most people would head out of the city and head down the coast or up the coast to go fishing, but today I did the opposite. I came from down the coast and headed up here to Sydney to have a day in the harbour. I've never really fished the harbour that much before. The first time I've really fished it for bream was today, and I have to say that it was a real eye-opener. The amount of different structure to fish up here, bridges, wharves, moored boats, man-made rocky walls, it's just a totally different alien sort of system to one I'm used to, which is more sort of natural, you know, snags and rocky walls and so on. So it took a little while to work out, you know, the best way to fish this area, and it also took a little while to sort of get used to the fact that this is a working harbour. There's boats and ferries and all sorts of crazy stuff going on all over the place. It's so different to the coastal waters I normally fish. So it was a real eye-opener to come up here, but I have to say the fishing's pretty good. This harbour is alive with fish. There's bait everywhere. We've got some nice little bream. I got blown away by something I reckon was probably a rat king on bream gear. And you know, you hear stories about all the fantastic fishing in here. And I've published plenty of stories over the years in Fishing World about the great fishing in Sydney Harbour. So it's a real eye-opener to come here and fish this area. And maybe it's true that you don't necessarily need to escape the city to have great fishing. What do we got here? I don't think it's a bream. See that bait? There's a shower of bait just where I chucked my lure and hooked up on whatever this is. Not sure what it is. Oh, it is a bream. It's a good bream. He had a good run on him. I thought he was a salmon or something like that. Some more fish just there. Starting to bust up on the surface. Come on, mate. All right. Yeah, quality fish. It's a good example of a nice, healthy Sydney Harbour bream. When it comes to selecting lures for bream, there's almost limitless amount of lures out there. I use a lot of hard bodies for bream, and you can sort of roughly define hard bodies into a couple of different categories. First up, you've got your shallow divers. So these little guys, like this little Atomic, they're great for shallow weed beds, shallow sand flats over shallow rocky bars. And then you might go to a deeper diving lure like this Jackal Chubby. That guy gets down to about 6 or 8 feet, and it's great for prospecting around deeper snags, rocky areas, drop-offs and so on. And then you've got your minnow style lures, which are your more elongated style lures. These are great for twitching around snags and through weed beds and along rock bars. Fantastic for that sort of work. And you've got sort of hybrid ones like this fellow, which is sort of a mix between a little fat hard body and more of a minnow style lure. So there, that's a little eco gear. It's good for doing that twitching sort of work as well. Not a big fish, but not a bad little fish. Come on, up you come. Got it. Another nice Sydney bream.